Today we want to talk about the basics of reverse osmosis. So how does it work? What are the important parameters, important values? And we'll have a look at the design process in detail. How is a reverse osmosis system designed? We'll have a look also at parameters influencing the design. For example, requirements of the client or the water analysis. And finally, we'll have a look at different process chains, so typical unit configurations that we often see at HERCO. We'll start with the basics. Working principle of the RO, we'll not go back to the very basic, but if you miss some part, just write in the chat and we'll try to explain. We'll have a look at the important values, important parameters. At element characteristics, so what kind of element can you use and what does it mean to have a different element in the reverse osmosis. We'll have a quick look also at scaling and fouling, you know that already from the water analysis webinar, and we'll have a look at the different types of elements that we most commonly use at HERCO.
Yeah, to start things off, we will start with the working principle of a reverse osmosis. On the right hand side, you see a typical flow chart of a reverse osmosis unit. So we start on the left side of this chart with the feed water, which then passes a high pressure pump to increase the pressure to overcome the osmotic pressure, which you already learned in a previous webinar. This high pressure pressurized water will then enter the membrane module where the semi-permeable membrane is located. And this is where the water streams are separated into, on the one hand side, the permeate, which is more or less clean water without salt in it. And the other stream is the concentrate, which is the lower amount of water with a higher amount of salt in it. Which is also important is the concentrate recirculation, which can be seen right there. And this is basically needed to increase the feed flow velocity in the membrane to reduce scaling later on.
Okay, brilliant. And now we'll go from here to talk about some parameters or values. Normally, you know that from our plants, usually we have a feed pressure of approximately 10 to 20 bars. Of course, this depends on the feed water TDS. And the element type. You see here an example with 1000 ppm TDS in the feed water. If you work with brackish water applications with up to 5000 ppm or seawater up 35,000 or higher, you will have higher pressures too. Permeate recovery is in standard units 75% to 80%. There are also applications where, for example, the water cost is high or we need to really save water. There we can use a high recovery RO, we'll come to that later, which has maybe 85-95% of recovery. What is important here, you can see this example, this is 75% recovery. So think about, you have the feed water with 10 cubic meters per hour. 75 recovery means three parts of the four parts go as out as permeate, and only one part leaves as concentrate. And since all the salt that has been in, let's say, 4 times 2.5 cubic meters before is concentrated in 2.5 cubic meters, you have a fourfold increase. So that means you go from 1000 ppm to 4000 ppm. Now, very often, if the water quality, feed water quality is good, our plants can be operated with 80% recovery too. Mm-hmm. In that case, what do we reach in the concentrate?
Yeah, you have to keep in mind that the concentration of the salts is always dependent on the recovery. So if we increase the recovery to 80%, we will have about 5 times the concentration of salt in the concentrate stream.
Right, so 5,000. This is important to keep in mind because you will immediately see that has a huge effect on the scaling potential, okay? Now, salt rejection is also the second most important value. Typically, if you look at element data sheets from element producers or membrane producers, you see values higher than 99%. In real life, this is under controlled condition, under lab conditions, I think with lower recoveries also. In real life, you have 97 to 99%. We usually say in our data sheets 97%. it's not because our membranes are not so good, it's because we always put the conservative value.
Yeah, so the realistic value, so to speak. We will exactly. take a closer look at the data sheets later on in this webinar to see how the deviation looks in the data sheets.
Right, and actually you told me before also that depends on the type of salts you have, because if it's another type of salt, the rejection could be lower.
Yes, for example, silica will never be as high as the retention of a sulfate ion or so. So there are always differences in the different salts, but mm-hmm. in general, we say 97% to 99%.
Okay. Good, and finally, we have the flux. That's the water flow actually through the membrane in liters per square meters of membrane area and hour. That's a design value that you don't often see in the data sheets, and that is what we choose during the design process. But a very, very broad range, so that you have an idea where to look, is about between 20 to 40 liters per square meter and hour.
Yes. Then we will take a quick look at the element characteristics. How does a element look like? On the left side of this picture, we see the feed solution, which flows into the membrane and then passes through the membrane module. We see the membrane sheets in brown grayish color. Between those sheets, we got the green sheet, so to speak, the part where the permeate is being generated and then put into the tube in the middle of the membrane module, where it's where it flows out of the module, and the rest of the water just passes the membrane and leaves at the concentrate at the end of the membrane. So in general, you can take a look at the membranes like this. I hope you can see it a little bit. So the membrane would be, or the water would flow like this, and some of the water will flow through the membrane into the middle of this, and then be in the permeate mm-hmm. flow, and then flow out of the module. Which is really important to see is this feed water carrier, which we see, because this prevents, if you take another look at this, the modules are spirally wounded about around the permeate tube, and the harder you wound it around it, the less space you need. But you can see there won't be any water flowing through here, so you need some kind of space in between to have the water flow through. I hope mm-hmm. you see it a little bit. And this feed water carrier, the spaces in the membrane are really important to reduce scaling and or fouling in the membrane. And we will take a closer look at this later on.
Exactly. So this is what the spacers are also about. And that's why you have different configurations of elements also, different spacers. That's scaling and fouling. So we talked about that in the webinar about the water analysis. We had this example of, for example, barium sulfate, which has a very, very low solubility. So as soon as the concentration goes up a little bit, it starts to exceed the solubility product, it starts to precipitate, and then you have scaling on the membrane. And of course, you can imagine the higher the recovery, as we discussed before, the higher the concentration in the concentrate at the end of the module, and the more scaling you can get there. You can also, we have these typical candidates like barium sulfate, calcium sulfate, we have silica scaling also. And we can also have fouling from colloidal substances. This is what we measure with SDI, if you remember the webinar, silt density index. This is a common problem if you have organic contamination, like surface waters, wastewaters. For us, scaling is usually more of a problem if you have well water or drinking water, but still, we can have fouling as well. You see here an example of a membrane with a scaling layer. This is from Avista. Some certain imaging has been used here to have different colors. So you can see here very well that you have scaling with different materials. Okay, and now we'll go right back to the membrane elements.
Yes, so there are different types of membrane elements, as you probably know. The first membrane modules were developed in the 1950s, 1960s. back in the days, there were some suppliers only, and the differences in quality were really, really high. Some examples of membranes are obviously Hydronautics, so Nitto, Toray, Filmtec, and the others. On the right-hand side, you see a little chart of the market size in 2009, but we will not say any more about this. So, which is really important for us is to give you an idea of the naming of the membranes. We took an example of Hydronautics, an ESPA 1 4040 membrane, where you see this ESPA 1 on the, in the at the beginning is the type of membrane. In this case, it's a reverse osmosis membrane. The one is also the membrane type. In this case, it's a low pressure membrane. The two would indicate a high pressure membrane. And then the 4040 at the end basically shows how big the diameter is, 40 inch in this case. And then the length of the membrane multiplied by 10, so 400 inches in length.
Right. And I think this, the 4040 element and the 8040 are the most common ones. So I think probably under 2 cubic meters or so, we have the 4040.
Yeah, it's a bit hard to say. A little bit bigger, but yeah. The most common we use are the 4040 and 8040, and the bigger systems obviously have the bigger membranes in it.
Okay. So if you look at this, we wanted to give you a bit more information. Of course, this is Hydronautics. There are other suppliers, but you always have a let's say a similar range, low pressure membranes, high rejection membranes, and so on. These are the ones that we use most commonly, I'd say. So it's the ESPA family. ESPA stands for energy saving polyamide. There's ESPA 1, ESPA 2, and ESPA 4. ESPA 1 is used if you want a lower pressure. So usually for low TDS feed water, it's quite similar to ESPA 2, but it's rather optimized for the pressure. And ESPA 2 is rather optimized to have a low TDS in the permit, so a bit higher salt rejection. ESPA 4 is usually used in a second pass, for example. We also have a high rejection membrane, CPA 2 in our case, usually. CPA stands for composite polyamide. And this one is used for treatment of brackish water, for example.
Yes, you need a higher pressure to produce the same amount of water, but we will go on to this topic later on in this webinar as well.
Exactly.
So now we got two types of elements, two data sheets. On the one hand side, Hydronautics, on the other side, the Filmtec module. And I want you guys to take a closer look at these because there's a survey coming regarding those two data sheets. So please take a closer look and think about which element would you say has the better performance or is the better membrane element. We will give you a couple of seconds to take a closer look and then skip to the survey afterwards.
You can see we decided to make the service a bit more complicated because I think you all guys, it was too easy for you. but have a look. They look quite different. I mean, the structure is a bit different. Have a look at the salt rejection values. They're given in a slightly different manner. Have a look also at how they were tested. And have a look at how they were tested, the boundary conditions. And then we'll have a look at the survey to ask you.
So I would say none of you was wrong in this survey because we highlighted some components of the data sheets to show you. We got the performance of 99.3, 99%, etc. But the more important thing are the test conditions in this case. So the upper element has the test condition of a sodium chloride solution with a concentration of 1,500 ppm. On the data sheet on the bottom, we got a concentration of 2000 ppm sodium chloride. So this makes it really hard to compare a salt rejection because the feed solution was differing. This makes the comparison a little bit hard. Furthermore, this minimum maximum salt rejection, it doesn't say how do they calculate it, or what's the minimum, what's the maximum salt rejection. So in our eyes, it's hard to compare these two modules just based on the data sheets. And this is why we also test new membranes if we decide to change our membranes in our facility here, to really see how do they perform, how do the membrane elements perform under real conditions, not laboratory test conditions, but we use our tap water here. So these are real operating conditions, and we can see if there are deviations, and if there are, we know which membrane to take.
Exactly. Yeah, somebody remarked the pressure used in the tests was different. Exactly, yep. You're right, because obviously we will need also different pressure to have the same recovery with different salt concentrations.
Yes.
So yeah, so what we do is normally we have a testing unit where we can put in four membranes at the same time, use the same water, same temperature, same pH, for example, if we change the pH, and then really determine if they are according to spec or they're not. Now we'll go right into the design of the RO unit. So we'll have a look at what design program you can use. Then we'll check the most basic part of the design, the ion balance. We'll see how you can put in the data into IMS design, which is the design program that we use. And we'll have a look at different configurations, stage versus pass, and how the calculation results are displayed and can be interpreted. And finally, we'll have a look also at permit quality in the elements and vessels, because that's something that you might need to check if you do troubleshooting on site, and it's important to understand how it differs in different elements.
So yeah, as Birgit already said, there are different design programs. Every major module supplier has an own designed program for their membranes, obviously, which uses the databases of the suppliers' tests. And in our case, we use the IMS design, which is the program from Nitto Hydronautics to design our systems. And to show you a little bit about this program and different parameters in it, we will get into the design right now. And Birgit, I guess you will take over from here a little bit.
Exactly. So we'll start with ion balance. This is how you put in the ion balance in the design program. We just took some part of the screen so that you can really see the ions. We will show you the complete screen later. Why do we have to do this? Obviously, anions and cations have to balance out because you have electron neutrality in the water. You cannot balance them out just using the milligrams per liter, because you need to think about the charges and not how much the ion weighs. So the balancing is done either by converting the values in milligram per liter of the ions into millimoles per liter, or into ppm calcium carbonate. In this case, and I think in a lot of other programs, we use milligram per liter calcium carbonate. The program does that for you. So you put in the milligram per liter values of the cations on the left-hand side and ions on the right-hand side, and the program gives you automatically milligram per liter calcium carbonate. If you check the molecular weights, of course, you can do it yourself in Excel, but it's easier this way. The water is considered balanced when the deviation between the total sums, milli equivalents per liter, so milli, same as millimole, let's say, per liter, is less than 10%. You see the total here, total milli equivalent per liter, left and right hand side. This one is balanced. 5.3 to 5.36 is not a big difference, so this would be fine. Very often, some ions are missing. Typical example is bicarbonate. It's not given, or it's given in a different form. So for example, you have an alkalinity value or a CNM value. In this case, you have to convert it to milligrams per liter, and then you can put it in the program. If something is missing, usually you see that right away, because you get some sort of fault message that the cation and ion balance simply doesn't tally. And then you have to think about what is missing and how can you balance these ions. After that, you fill in the physical chemical data. So basically water type, but I think it's always brackish non-fouling,
yes,
right?
In our cases, yes.
And the pH value, the temperature, gas concentrations you don't need to fill in, that's calculated by the program. For example, you put in ammonium, and NH3 is then calculated for the pH, let's say. Finally, you have at the bottom here the saturation calculation. The program does that for you. So with your input, you see already for the important constituents for scaling, if they are, let's say, near to 100% saturation, which means precipitation is likely to occur, or if they're still pretty low. You get also a fault message, I think, right?
Yes, you do. But in usual cases, the feed water should not have any warnings in it.
True.
Because this has to be out of some well or some
Or you need to think about your pre-treatment.
Yes, you should definitely do this then. So after filling in the feed water parameters, the irons, the next thing you have to do is put some data into the system to get the actual design of the unit. In this case, we showed you the stages 1 and 2 on the in yellow. We used a element type, ESPA1, which we already showed you early on, so a low pressure membrane. And then just below it, the elements and vessels are shown. So here we actually design the unit, how many pressure vessels do we have and how many membranes are inside of each pressure vessel. In this case, we got 2 elements per pressure vessel. And then we got 1 pressure vessel with these 2 membranes in it, followed by another pressure vessel with 2 membranes in it. Furthermore, you have to obviously design the input the recovery you want to go with and the pH if you want to shift it into a direction. But this is the general idea about the data input to design the unit.
Okay, so if you have the ion balance, you have already system specification, then you can go on and calculate. But first of all, we wanted to show you something here because you see here stages and you see also passes. We want to explain what the difference between that is. If we have a 2-stage RO system, that's basically what you have seen before. That means we come into the first stage with the feed water. We take out the permeate and we go with the concentrate in the second stage. So 1 stage is typically 1 pressure vessel, really. And very often you see this Christmas tree design. So let's say you come after the high pressure pump, you divide up the flow into 2 pressure vessels. Here it's always symbolized with just 1 symbol, but it could be 2 pressure vessels in parallel. And then you come out with a concentrate from these 2 and go later to 1 pressure vessel, which would be here the second one.
Exactly.
That's a typical design. This is not a pass, however, and Holger will explain to you how passes work.
Yeah, big difference between pass and stage. The pass is a little bit different. In this case, we showed you the second pass of a permeate staged unit from us. So the permeate from the first pass is then treated by another reverse osmosis system, so to speak. So in this case, we want a better salt rejection, a better quality of our permeate water. The other option would be to have a concentrate pass unit where we would use the concentrate from the first unit and put it into a second unit to then decrease the wastewater and increase our overall recovery, because we can use the permeate from the second pass to put it back in the front to the first pass.
All right, we'll explain that also later.
Yes, we will get to this point as well. To show you why this pass system is a thing that might come in handy for you, we prepared some basic calculations to just show you the difference between a single pass and a 2-pass system right now.
Right, so this is the single pass system. Here you see also the whole screen of the IMS design. You can see here that there's only pass 1, so that you don't see anywhere pass 2, so it's only 1 pass. And you can see the TDS we have at the end, and that's the TDS in the permeate in this red circle, and that's 15 milligrams per liter. So that's a typical, let's say, single pass system result.
Yes.
Now we go to the 2-pass system.
Yes, and I will take over from here. So the 2-pass system has the second reverse osmosis to treat the permeate of the first pass. And you can see in the highlighted area again, the TDS of this 2-pass system, which is way, way lower than the single pass unit. So you see the actual influence the second reverse osmosis stage has on your product water quality.
All right, that's very clear, I think. Now we come to the last point of this chapter, and that's permeate quality in the different elements or vessels. This is an example, really. So you see, we come in with a TDS of 405 milligrams per liter. That's our feed water. We'll have immediately at point two a higher TDS of 718, but that is because we have a concentrate recirculation, exactly the green line, where we need to return concentrate in order to have enough cross flow velocity over the module. Okay, then we pass the module and we come out with a permeate with a low TDS, 11 milligrams per liter, and a concentrate with a TDS that's a lot higher, that's 1095. That was the first pressure vessel, actually. So the TDS of the concentrate is still not quite as high as what you would expect from the whole system. So we come into the second pressure vessel now. We go out with a TDS of 1600 milligrams per liter almost. Point number six and seven here would have the same TDS, obviously, because that's all concentrate flow. And you see also then we have a second permeate flow. That's point number nine. And you see that here the TDS is a bit higher. This is obviously not because the element is better or whatever. It's simply that you get the better feed water in the first pressure vessel. So we'll have the lowest TDS coming out of the pressure vessel in the permeate. You will have a higher, slightly higher TDS in the permeate coming out from the second pressure vessel. And if we had a third one, it would be higher again. And then the total permeate has a mixture of these values. So if you want to check if you have some problems and you see that you want to troubleshoot, you usually can check the permeate quality after each vessel with some sort of sampling port, small blue ones, right? So you can check there, and you would expect to have these slight differences, obviously. But if you have, for example, first the TDS of, let's say 10, and the next one is 300, then you would think about if there's something wrong with the element. Yes.
You can also see the TDS value from position one, 405, to position five, six, and seven, almost 1600. So this is round about this factor four, which we told you at the beginning. So our concentrate is basically four times as highly concentrated as our feed water.
Exactly. Now we come to the parameters influencing the design. We try to group them a bit. There are lots of parameters, obviously, but one is water analysis. So basically the conditions of the feed water, whether that is salt concentration, temperature, pH, whatever. The second group of parameters would be process requirements. So this goes already into this single pass, two pass system. If you need a lower conductivity in your permeate, you will have to go for a two pass system or maybe even EDI.
Exactly.
And finally, unit efficiency. And by that, we mean water and energy efficiency. So maybe you have requirements that energy consumption should be low, or maybe you want to save water, so your recovery has to reach a certain level.
Yeah, to start things off, we go for the water analysis. We got several parameters which influence our design in case of feed water. So on the one hand side, we got the TDS, obviously. The higher the TDS is, the more possibilities of scaling there are, so to speak. We also got the feed water temperature, which is a really important parameter. This is unfortunately often not really taken a look at, but I will come to this later on. We also have the feed water pH, which obviously has a big impact on gases in the water, so soluted gases. We got scaling and fouling tendency depending on the feed water, which basically has to be dealt with by our pretreatment. So the consequences of the design to the actual parameters. So in the TDS thing, you got the higher the TDS is, the more pressure you need. So if you have a lower TDS than designed, a pump with a variable frequency drive, VFD, might come in handy because you can save a lot of energy in the operation. In case of temperature, this can have an impact on the flux, because the warmer the water gets, the bigger the flux is, which we will also come to later on. So the recovery of the unit might be or might have to be taken into account. Then we got an adjustment of the feed pH to see, do we have some substances which tend to cause scaling or fouling in regards of the pH value. And obviously, as I already said, scaling fouling has to be dealt with a pre-treatment. Besides, we got a little chart of the temperature. So you see, the more the temperature increases, the higher the permeate flux becomes, which also has an impact on the salt rejection though. So the higher the temperature gets, the lower your salt rejection is. You can basically explain it because the warmer the water is, the better the salt ions can move through the water and also through the membrane, unfortunately. So if you have a higher temperature, this means you need a lower pressure to have the same flux, which obviously goes towards the VFD pumps. And you will also have to take into account that the salt rejection becomes lower with a higher water temperature. So you need less pressure, but you also have a slightly worse water quality in the permeate. To show you how this looks in numbers, not only in this cryptic graph, we also prepared some basic designs, which I will show you right here. So we got two temperatures, which you can see on the top, temperature 15 degrees centigrade on the left-hand side and 20 on the right-hand side. So only 5 degrees difference, but this has a pretty huge impact in my eyes. You can see the feed pressure, which is at 11 or 10 to 11 bar on the left-hand side, and 5 degrees centigrade warmer water leads to round about 2 bar less pressure you need. So this actually impacts your pump, and you can imagine that the energy savings of a VFD pump will be pretty high in this case. The other thing that's affected is the TDS, which you can see on the left-hand side, 15 degrees centigrade, we got around about 15 milligrams per liter TDS, and on the right-hand side, we are almost at 17 milligrams per liter. So you see what I just showed you at the graph, now in numbers, you actually get a really low pressure you need, but a slightly worse permeate concentration if the temperature goes up. So you have to definitely keep this parameter in your mind when you design a unit.
Exactly. And this is also really important for the operation costs. We have talked about this in a previous webinar on energy efficiency, actually. So I've taken a slide from there to just illustrate this. You see here the energy consumption with different temperatures. Actually here you have one is, it's always P1, so the energy you take from the grid, let's say. And you have the option in blue with a pump without variable frequency drive, so a pump you cannot adjust. And in orange, a pump with variable frequency drive. This scenario is for the AS or AS series, so from about 1.5 cubic meters until 30 cubic meters, all the sizes. And what we have compared here, we said the TDS is actually 1000 milligram per liter, so that's our design point for the unit. But the temperature is 20 degrees Celsius instead of 15 degrees Celsius, the design point. Feed pressure is 2 bar, this is also our design point. So only one parameter is actually deviating from our design conditions. And still you see, we have quite a lot of, quite a large reduction in energy. Because when you take a normal pump without variable frequency drive, as Holger explained just now, you will have a higher flow rate with a higher temperature, but you cannot use that. Let's say you have a higher flow rate, you need a lower pressure, but you will have to throttle the pump to get to the operation point that is fixed. And that means you won't save any pressure. You will just maybe even use a little bit more. But if you use a variable frequency drive pump, the orange line, you can actually save a lot of pressure and thereby a lot of energy because you need less pressure for the 20 degree water. You see here that on average, this is about 1/3 of the energy use actually. Depending on the size of the unit, can be between, let's say, 20 to 50%. So for some units, it's really huge where you have a pump with a lot of reserves. And what is important for you, for the operation conditions, the variable frequency drive pump is a bit more expensive. But you have usually a break even already after 2 years for units larger than 5 cubic meters. And I think for units larger than 7 or 8 cubic meters, the break even is after less than 1 year.
Yes, and we shouldn't forget this is only one parameter that has changed.
Exactly.
So if your water temperature is 20 degrees centigrade and you only have a TDS of, let's say, 400 milligrams per liter, as we had in our previous example, this discrepancy will increase even more and the VFD unit will amortize even faster.
Exactly. So it can easily be that after 4 months, it's already you're already at break even. And after 10 years, imagine you will have a lot less operation cost. So this is important to explain to the client as well. And it's really typical that we have also less TDS because we need to design with a certain reserve so that we are pretty sure even when you don't have a water analysis, the system is going to work. So if your TDS is lower, if your temperature is higher, you can easily save probably more than 50% of energy.
Yes.
Okay, now we come to the, I think that's still my slide.
Yes.
We come to the process requirements. That's the second part. So until now, it was all feed water requirements. Now we have certain requirements from the process, from the client typically. Examples of this can be, if we want to produce rinsing water for the automotive industry, we need maybe 20 microsiemens per centimeter in the permit. If we want to produce ultra pure water, let's say for microelectronics, actually microelectronics would be even cleaner than this one. Or let's say for a power plant with a high pressure, then we need pretty low conductivities. So maybe lower than 0.1 microsiemens per centimeter, that's equivalent to 10 mega ohm. Or maybe even, like you see here in the example, 16 to 18 mega ohms. We could also have the need to remove CO2 because we have an EDI after the reverse osmosis. We need to reach these very low conductivities. And in order not to put too much load on the EDI, we need to remove the CO2 beforehand. Another example, also from the microelectronics industry, is sometimes you want to have very low boron concentrations. In that case, you might need to adjust the process or the membranes to have a higher rejection of boron. Consequences for the design. If you have a very low conductivity, you might need a two-pass RO, like we explained, or in case of these values, you might need an EDI, actually, or maybe even two-pass and EDI. We have cases like that also.
Yes.
You might want to include a membrane degassing stage if you need to remove CO2. I think we'll have an example of that afterwards.
Mm-hmm.
Or you might want to adjust the pH. That's the other version how you can remove it easier. If you have, for example, if you need a high boron rejection, you might want to use a special membrane that has a higher rejection than the standard ones. Now, there's an example for CO2. How does that work?
Yeah, it's also a pretty interesting thing because CO2 will always be in your water. It only depends on the feed pH and then obviously the concentration of bicarbonate in the water. So in this example, we took the same water analysis as in the examples previous to this. We got a feed pH of 7.55 and a CO2 concentration in the permeate of 10 ppm. Roughly. And then we got the option to increase the feed pH to put the CO2 into a different state and to produce, so to speak, bicarbonate and lower the CO2 concentration. You can see this leads to a CO2 concentration of 1.2 roundabout ppm in the permeate. So there's a pretty big difference, almost 10 times lower in the CO2 department, which should influence the conductivity, you should say, because, well, obviously there's less CO2 in it. But on the next slide, we can see that the TDS value, or in this case, the conductivity, is not really differing like we would assume.
Yeah, actually, it's even a bit higher than the second case.
Which is basically only related to the sodium hydroxide, we insert into the water, we have to increase the feed pH, so we use caustic, and this brings sodium ions into the water, which obviously increase our feed water conductivity, and this will also increase our permeate conductivity in this case. So here we see a standard single pass or one pass RO unit with caustic dosing. The only thing the dosing did was our permeate pH will be a little bit more to the neutral side if we increase the feed pH, but conductivity wise it has no positive impact, so to speak. So on the next slide we see a two pass system, which becomes a little bit more interesting, because also on the left hand side we see the feed pH, which is 7.55, the CO2 concentration in the permeate 10.7, just like on the previous slide. On the right hand side we see a feed pH of 8.5 and also a CO2 concentration in the permeate of 1.2, so same as previously. But if we now take a look at our conductivities, now we see that the low feed pH with the high CO2 concentration in the permeate leads to a conductivity of 5.6 microsiemens per centimeter. And if we use caustic dosing in the feed, we lower the permeate conductivity to 4.1. This now, obviously, the impact of the caustic dosing is the same. We increase our feed water conductivity. But in low conductivities, the impact that CO2 has on our overall conductivity of the permeate water is way higher. So in this case, we lowered this CO2 concentration and therefore got a lower concentration or a lower conductivity in our permeate. This is the reason why caustic dosing can be used in these very low permeate conductivity waters to lower our conductivity even more. Next to the point, obviously, if you have an EDI afterwards, you have to remove the CO2. But this is the basic idea of CO2 and caustic dosing in a two-pass system, why we use it and why its impact is a little bit limited in the single-pass systems.
Very interesting. Okay. So now we come to the third part, really, and that's unit efficiency. So we had a look at the influence of the water analysis, influence of requirements for the permeate. And now sometimes, and I think nowadays actually more and more, we have requirements for water efficiency or energy efficiency. You have a standard RO unit. You have a recovery of 75 to 80%. It's important to stress that because we warrant 75%, but the feed water is not 1,000 milligram per liter, but is lower, you can actually do 80%. So it's also important to think about at the startup, maybe you can actually put the unit to 80% and save water with that already, because if the feed water quality is sufficient, this is perfectly possible with the units.
Yes.
This is something that maybe also the end client often doesn't think about. So keep that in mind when you're discussing. But even 80% is sometimes not sufficient. We also have double pass RO units, the UOS7 KR series. We did a webinar on the KR series beginning of this year when we changed it to Siemens S7 controller. You can have a look at that in YouTube too and see, look at the details. Here we have a permeate recovery of 85 to 90%. So that's already quite a bit higher. And we have also something very interesting. We have our brackish water series. If you know the series well, you will be surprised now because it says UOD, so it means RO Digital. We're going to change it for the new price list for next year to RO Digital. So we have already included this. And this brackish water series can be used simply for brackish water. But, and this is also very, very interesting application, that we think will be more and more important, it can be used for a retrofit. So you could use this to retrofit an existing system. I think I have some more details in the next slide. And you reduce, as with a KR unit, the concentrate production, let's say by 50%, 60%, even 70%. So that's for water efficiency. Energy efficiency is the other topic. We have talked about the energy use already just now with the temperature. generally you always have this this topic that you throttle a standard RO unit with a valve and you waste energy. If you have a VFD pump, a variable frequency drive pump, you will always just use the energy that you need with the operating conditions, no matter how the design conditions were. We offer the VFD versions, that's called FU in Germany, that's why the units are called FU with a code, to save energy. We always have a FU version, and for the brackish water series, we will also have only FU versions from now on, because then it really, really makes sense to have the variable frequency drive, because you get the money back after 3 months already or so, because the TDS concentrations are higher. Okay, here an example of the unit efficiency. This is the KR series. Maybe some of you know this brochure. If you have a KR series and you compare it, a KR unit, compare it to a normal UOD and D unit with a 75% yield, and you go from 75% to 90% yield, you have a break even. So the additional cost of the KR is recovered already after less than 1 year. And after 10 years, if you think about it, the total life cycle cost is 20% lower. And if you have seen our previous webinars, you see that the life cycle cost of the unit, I always find this very surprising. The investment is like a small part, maybe 10, 15, 20% maximum. I think more like 15. The energy is also like, let's say 15, 20%. And water use is such a large part. So it's really, really worth it to think about reducing your wastewater in order to save money for the client. Okay, you can still reduce also the energy consumption with a VFD, so you have an additional saving. And the same goes pretty much for the BV series, UOD brackish water series as a retrofit. If you if the client has already a unit installed and he wants to produce less wastewater, but let's say he doesn't want to replace his unit completely, maybe it's relatively new, maybe wants to be on the safe side, maybe he has several RO units, then you can use the brackish water series as a retrofit, collect all the concentrate streams, feed it into the brackish water unit, and then reduce with that the wastewater production by 50 or 70%. So it's worth it, like the KR series, if the wastewater and water costs are high, higher than 2 euros per cubic meter. And actually you get 2 euros per cubic meter in a lot of locations. Yes. I think more than half of the locations for sure. Yeah. Probably a lot more.
A little bit more, yeah.
Yeah, three quarters most probably. Christian did a very interesting presentation on this topic of the BV series as a retrofit at the Aquatech. Maybe some of you have seen it. But we're going to offer that as a webinar probably next year as well. Okay, so in general, unit efficiency is something that we want to cover in more detail. You've seen that in the webinars because we think it's something really important. We've seen also in not only in, let's say, Spain or Italy, where you have water scarcity. We've seen that in Belgium as well, that due to climate change, it's a really, really important topic. And it's something that the end client sees also with the costs, because water tariffs are set to increase as well. So it makes a lot of sense to think about the efficiency when you look for a new unit and to discuss this with the client and to show him the advantages. Process chains.
Yeah, let's go on with the process chains at the end to just show you a little bit what we do. So we got the Herco RO series, we got our standard RO series, the KR, so the concentrate recovering stages, the NDP, the permeate increased quality, and then our UPS7, the EDI units.
So these are our series. You don't need to look at everything. I think it's just good to have an overview just to see how they are grouped. So you see here on the left-hand side, those are all the units that are pretty much, let's say, the standard units for softened water with a standard permeate recovery, 75 to 80%, and a conductivity in the permeate less than 20 microsiemens per centimeter, typical configuration. Obviously, it varies with the feed water composition. Okay. You have the very small series, the combi series with an included C and CD with the softener included. And you have our very, very general series, UOD and UOD ND, the larger ones. We have the counter pressure series that's more like for buildings. And we have two versions of the ND and NDRM. All of these are basically standard. Okay, so these have the standard recovery, standard conductivity in the permit. Then we have on the right-hand side top units with either high permit quality or high yield. So the KR has a higher recovery than normal. We have 90% instead of 75-80. The NDP has a better quality. So we have 5 microsiemens per centimeter since it's a two-pass system. 5 microsiemens per centimeter in the permit instead of 20 microsiemens. And we have finally, for even higher requirements, the UP units, where we have typically less than 0.2 microsiemens per centimeter. Okay. And then at the bottom, those are all the anti-scalant units, really, or let's say for water that is not softened. Okay. That's the AS series and the brackish water and the seawater series. Keep in mind, we're going to redesign the brackish water series for next year, and we're going to switch it from the RO1000 controller, which is a relatively old one, to the RO digital controller.
Yes, then we'll give you a short overview of our standard RO units. As Birgit already said, our TDS value that we use for our design is 1000 milligrams per liter with a temperature of 15 degrees centigrade. With our standard units, we can achieve a typical recovery of around 75 to 80%. We get a typical conductivity in our permeate of below 20 microsiemens per centimeter, which is basically a salt rejection of 97% to 99%. These are, as we said, the standard RO units. So the most applications can be dealt with a standard RO unit, but we also have some more sophisticated units, so to speak, and I guess you will show us one of them.
Exactly. So this is the KR. We already talked about the advantages in operation costs for the client. We have, as we said, depending on the unit size, a typical recovery between 85 to 90%. Conductivity is similar to the ones of the standard units, and the salt rejection is a little bit higher with this one. But that's partly because of the configuration, really. Typical applications, we have a lot of these units in the food and beverage industry, actually, because I think for this industry, water saving is a very important topic. Same goes for data centers, which is where we see a lot of projects right now as well. People are thinking a lot about the energy efficiency of data centers. So it makes sense to have a high recovery unit there as well. Generally, it's always a good idea to quote this instead of a standard unit if the water or wastewater costs are high, and high means already less than 2, so actually we should say middling, because then you have a really quick break-even point. Or, and that's also the case for some clients, they simply have a wastewater discharge permit and they cannot go above that, but they want to increase production, so the only option they have is basically to reduce their wastewater flow. So increase recovery.
From one two-pass unit to the other, our UNDP series, already talked about this as well. Basically a reverse osmosis followed by another reverse osmosis to increase our rejection to lower the conductivity in our permeate. Also, these units are designed for a TDS of 1000 milligrams per liter, 15 degrees centigrade as usual. The recovery rates here are a little bit lower because we got these two reverse osmosis systems. So our recovery is at about 71%. The typical conductivity in our permeate is 5 microsiemens per centimeter. And we already told you that the salt rejection is a little bit higher, 99.5% roundabout. The typical applications for these units are cosmetic, pharmaceutical, let's say customers who need a quality of about 5 or lower than 5 microsiemens per centimeter. The key number is 4.3 microsiemens per centimeter here. So these units fit for this. We also use them or did sell them to hospitals who need it for their cleaning processes.
Right. I think this is also hospital application for this unit. And we wanted to show you a more interesting one than the typical ones, right?
Yes, obviously.
This is a cooler one, but this is also something that we do. So this actually, you see this is based on the AS series, right? And but then it's done as a double pass system. Okay, then we come to another unit with a very high quality. That's basically the EDI. So if you need even a better quality than these 5 microsiemens, if you need, let's say, less than about 0.2 microsiemens per centimeter, that would be correspond to 5 megaohm, or you need more, let's say 10 megaohm, 15. You need a UP system, so RO plus EDI. You have these requirements usually in, let's say, pharmaceutical or similar areas, could be also cosmetics, could be also life science. Yeah, you have, if you have power plants with a very high pressure, you can have these requirements too. I think we had a lot of power plant applications, yes, actually with these ones. Yep. And if you have microelectronics, you also have very, very stringent requirements. Another new application that we have seen is green hydrogen, where we very often use a UP as well. But it depends a bit on the type. Sometimes you can work with an NDP, whatever. But we're going to have a webinar about that pretty soon for the group as well. This is, again, a unit that's not like the typical one you see in the price list, because we wanted to show you some special units. This is a unit where you see that everything is stainless steel. You have a diluent tank with the units. You have also UV treatment. So this is also sort of a special application here.